I will. Let me first say hi, everybody. Really excited to see so many people from across the world. And thank you, Scott, for the introduction. You just made me feel very old. It means you just highlight the fact that I indeed graduated back in 1992. Oh my God. So just to get it out there, I'm 50 years old. So I turned 50 this year. So. 1992, imagine. And indeed, 2003, everybody thinks that I'm sort of the Scrum guy, but I actually started with extreme programming back in 2003, which I enjoyed so much. And which, by the way, looking back, was really, really good and really helpful, because we started with extreme programming and then sort of we added Scrum to that in a way, as sort of to organize stuff slightly better. But that helped me, as from the day one, see the importance of having great development, engineering, whatever practices within Scrum. I've never done otherwise. I notice how that sometimes for people is different when they sort of start with Scrum and then they would have to think about development practices or whatever, and Scrum doesn't prescribe them and they have difficulties. So that was sort of like a lot of things in my life, just plain luck. Nothing planned, nothing. It was just, I was just being lucky. Cool. I really look forward to this talk. So I see a lot of people from around the world, some people that I've worked with in the past. So it's crazy, crazy, crazy. And like Greg, I don't know if anybody's seen it in the chat window, like Greg Pitcher said, wow, this is sort of at least one of the positive effects of all this COVID thing. Yeah, we've got all these online webinars and that we can get connected to a lot of people in the world. I've never done so many sort of events like the past month, and it keeps on going. People keep inviting me, so that's cool. It also puts a little pressure on me because I'm talking about how I see engagement being the key, and I'll explain why I think it's the key. But I never do the same things twice. Never. Not anything, not in work, not in personal life, whatever. So that means even if I'm talking about the same subject, I just can't stop changing my slides, changing the sequence, changing the angles, the perspective, the entrance points, the whatever. So that also makes it very difficult for me to predict. If you want, predictions are really, really scary things. Makes it really difficult to predict how long this is going to take, because I mess up my learnings every time again. So that's cool. So welcome in the world of let's say, unique and new product. What is most fascinating about this webinar, it's actually technically in Zoom, it's a meetup, because nowadays we all, you know, on these online platforms, you know, so technically it's a meeting in Zoom, but officially it's a sort of webinar. What is most fascinating about this webinar is that we're going to do breakout rooms. So this is the first webinar that I'm going to do breakout rooms. And it's great to do that because it was highlighted to me by the hosts, so Scott, Tony, and Daniel. By the way, thank you guys for having me. And they are so keen on connecting people and making sure that people can talk to each other. And I was, oh yeah, that's cool. That's so unique. Nobody does that. So let's go do that. So I've prepared a couple of things. First of all, a Mentimeter, so to get some ideas about you guys, because too many people to sort of direct talk to or one-on-one. And I've also created a PowerPoint, which is a sort of, don't need to very bad word. I'm also a Scrum trainer. And I see sometimes trainers saying, yeah, we've got this PowerPoint free course. And I'm like, well, I don't have PowerPoint free courses, but I don't think my courses are worse because of that. So that's sort of how people try to, I do PowerPoint too. I have a PowerPoint. But let's start with the Mentimeter. I'll show you. So I've got that this screen sharing stuff. I know how to mess these things up sometimes. But so I am at least hoping that you see my Mentimeter. If not, somebody will point it out to me probably or put it in the chat. So this is the Mentimeter. I don't know whether you're Mentimeter, but there's a website called menti.com. So you can go to menti.com. There's a code you can enter. So the 785361. And maybe as soon as I see some hearts appear or some cats appear, I know that you're in.
Oh, cool. Look.
I have no idea what the CAT stands for, by the way, but I like the symbol, so that's cool. Okay, like I said, I've got 4 or 5 points where we're going to lock you away in a breakout room. And this is the fourth point. This is the first point. And this is the question I would like you to take into your breakout room. So we're going to put you in breakout rooms of, I think, about at least 5, maybe 5, 6 people. Get to know each other, talk to each other, and also talk about the idea that business outcomes are actually important. Also in a world of Agile, in a world of Scrum, whatever, business outcomes are still important. And this is how I got up with the idea of the session. A few years back, an organization in Netherlands who has an Agile magazine asked me to contribute an article about performance and productivity. How to measure that and how to value that and so on. And that got me into this topic. So let's start from the beginning. Go into a breakout room. In the meantime, maybe with the 5, 6 people, enter some keywords for this. But answer the question, what does your organization currently, the organization you work for, or if you're a consultant, the organization that you work with or are engaged with, what does your organization currently monitor or measure in terms of performance and productivity? Meaning the ability to produce business outcomes. So what are metrics, what are measurements that they have in place, what do they keep an eye on?
Yeah, I think that's everybody back now.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. So let's put a little closing time box on this, 30 seconds to enter your... it seems fairly stable, sort of stable at the heart of this is measuring velocity, which is probably the most used metric, whatever, in Agile world and certainly in the world of Scrum. Although fascinatingly enough, the word is not even in the Scrum guide. So I see lots of things, velocity, cycle time, how long things take, throughput, and sort of assume that's a little bit like sort of output, how much you produce, how much work you burn down, maybe, output, cost of things. Okay, cool. Thank you. It seems that sort of a lot of people or in a lot of organizations, the idea of velocity is being used. It's indeed something that we see a lot, and it's probably the most abused thing anyhow in our beautiful world of Scrum. And I don't know whether it really contributes to, let's say, what I like to believe in, humanizing the workplace. So here's a little statement of mine. This is actually about the topic of today. So engagement is the key. So the statement says, employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. And what do they care about? About team outcomes, customer outcomes, enterprise outcomes. So you have the ability in your Mentimeter, in your menti.com to say, yeah, agree, not agree. So we quickly have some votes over there. So employees core, at the core of things is my belief, my sort of finding. The funny thing is that I sort of give away the conclusion of today's session, which is also always lovely to start with the conclusion. So employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. And then they care about team, customer, and enterprise outcomes. Okay, let's take 10 more seconds. It's always... In a way, the funny thing with this question is, to be honest to you guys, it's always scary to run into the situation where somebody would not agree. And that would be fascinating. Okay, let me... you're all talking about what do you currently measure and in terms of performance, productivity. Sure, I already know about my statement here. Yeah, so I'm glad that at least most people that participate seem to agree with this statement. So it's really sort of really helpful. Let me share how I came about this topic. So when I was asked about thinking about performance and productivity and performance also in terms of performance reviews and so on, you know, those whatever things that organizations organize, performance and productivity, I remembered this report. It's every couple of years. There's an institute in the US, the Gallup Institute. And every couple of years, they bring out a new report, which is about what they call the state of the global workplace. The last report was from 2017, as you can see, gathering data, summarizing data from 2014 until 2016. And it's all about engagement. And what is the scary thing about that report and those findings worldwide? That at a global scale, only 15% of the workforce, only 15% of the workforce says that they're really engaged for the company, that they're inspired by the company, that they go the extra mile for the company, that they believe in what the company stands for. And only 15%. Imagine working for a 1,000-person company, and there's only 150 people in that 1,000-person company saying, yeah, this is my company. I believe in this. I go for this. This is why I come to work spirited, full of enthusiasm. This is why I love to come to work, my company. Now, at a global scale, 67% says, well, sort of what I translate as sort of couldn't care less. You know, yeah, I know it's my company, but the things I really love to do are sort of happening outside of the company. When I go home in the evening. So they come in the morning. I don't know whether they have to check in or batch in or whatever. But at least maybe they should pass some gates and so on. The only thing that they look for all day long is sort of watching their watch, hoping they can go home quickly as possible, and then start doing the things that they really want to do. Sort of couldn't care less. Not cold, not warm. Now, that is not too brilliant. But the even more scary part of this is that at a global scale, 18% of the workforce says that they're actively disengaged. That's like working against the company or undoing the work of the engaged people. So imagine in a company of 1,000 people, 180 people actively working almost against the company. Sabotaging maybe other people within the company, teams, I don't know, slowing down stuff. That is sort of insane. Now, I live in Belgium, so we've got people from all over the world, so you can have a look at your region if you want. I live in Belgium, and still currently, to date, the UK is still part of Western Europe too. So, and in Western Europe, we do even worse. Only 10% engaged, 71% couldn't care less, and 19% actively disengaged. Now, assuming a lot of people are from York or around York in the UK, don't get up your hopes too high because the UK is not too brilliantly. It's better than the average Western Europe, but it's still less than the world average. 11%, 68%. Now, to give you some hope, that's slightly better than Belgium. So in my country, it seems that only 10% of the workforce says that they're really engaged for the company. Now, whether it's 10% or 15% or 11%, that is extremely low. That is extremely low. Imagine at a world scale, it means that 85% of the workforce of a company is not engaged for the company, not feeling inspired or energetic for their own company. It's different in different regions. So Greg is from New Zealand, slightly better than Western Europe, not the world scale. Yeah. So think about, let that sink in a little bit. That is really scary. So
there, just got to jump in. Question. There's a question coming in the slide, which is really interesting. Just on your previous slide. Somebody asked, why is the US/Canada 31% engaged? What are they doing differently to us? Have you got any experience of?
No, I've got the full report. By the way, you can download the full report from the Gallup site. You only have to register, but not pay for it. No, I haven't looked in sort of specific motivations and so on. But it's indeed, it's a lot better, that, because that's twice. I don't know, maybe people are scared to fill in the survey that somebody would watch over. No, that's a cynical side of me. No, let's take that seriously. It just means that in US and Canada, about 31% of all people say that they really are engaged for the company. Might have to do with scale. I can't really say. I have a look into the report. It also makes a distinction between people that are self-employed, working for a commercial organization, or working for government, and so on. So it's full of nitty-gritty details. But I focus on the fact that it's overall, because even the 31% of the US and Canada, that is, okay, a lot better than the global average, but still, in a way, only 31%. Now, what it is sort of scary. I did this. I shared these figures a while ago in Poland, and somebody said, "Oh, I know those engaged, not engaged, actively disengaged. I can even pick them from the company, and I know who they are. I even know who they are in my department and in my teams." Yeah, sort of scary. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. I have more detail for that. Have a look at the report. Yep. Okay, now engagement obviously is closely related to that Scrum value that we have. It's called commitment. I like engagement a little bit more because it has more like a positive feel to it, plus less of a sort of bad past that we have with commitment. Now, in my book that Scott referred to, so Scrum a Pocket Guide. Let me show you very, very quickly. So it's that second edition. I described the Scrum values, and I described commitment in line with how it was always intended in Scrum, not always understood. But commitment is more about the effort, the work that you put into it, the heart, you're putting your heart into your work. And I like to compare that to what the dictionary says. Imagine a trainer from a sports team, and the team has just lost the game, but the trainer stating, you know what, I can't fault my players for their commitment. They did everything they can. They worked hard, they tried, they didn't give up, they went into the game all the way up to the last seconds of the game. They tried, they changed stuff, we switched some people, we changed strategies, tactics, whatever. So I can't fault my players for their commitment. So commitment is not about a sort of actual outcome or promised result. It's more about the effort. I like it to be synonymous to dedication. So commitment is an expression of dedication. And so engagement, the low level of engagement that we see across the world means that there's a sort of low level of commitment. People are not committed to their work, maybe their team, their organization, their department, whatever they do. So the level of commitment is quite low, it seems, which is very scary. Now, if you all agree that people who are engaged, employees who are engaged, actually care a lot more, that seems to be a very important thing. So let's move into a breakout room again for 5 minutes. And then take this question into the breakout room, and Scott will publish it again to your breakout rooms probably. So in order to get that thing called engagement, what is needed first and foremost to establish an environment where people can actually engage, show their creativity, and in Scrum terms, commit? So what is needed to establish such an environment? So take 5 minutes again in your breakout rooms with your small teams. So thank you for entering your keywords. I do hope you have some fascinating conversations. I was just sharing with Scott, it's quite amazing that we have a very global audience today. From Greg, New Zealand, people, India. I think I've seen people from the US. It was also, it's quite amazing. So thank you. Let's see what comes in. Okay. So thanks for all these things. Like sort of in the previous one, velocity was at the heart of it and couldn't be beaten. Trust is one that comes back a lot. Autonomy, integrity, psychological safety, or safety as such. Can I add something about the safety aspect? I like the idea of safety a lot, but it's often not sort of in the way that people would, or traditional people would understand safety. So a while ago, I made a couple of recordings, small moves about stuff. And you know that we typically say in this world of Scrum that the Scrum Master is there to make sure that there's a safe environment. It's about safety. And for me, safety in our world means that it's actually very unsafe, because it's an environment where people speak up, go into conflict over ideas, discuss ideas, be open about stuff. And that's in a traditional sense a really unsafe environment. So safety means the ability to display or demonstrate traditionally unsafe behavior. Speaking up, not minding hierarchy, not minding seniors, things, whatever. Everybody has a right to speak up, defend their ideas, go into a constructive dialogue over those things. So in traditional way, quite unsafe actually. So that's cool. Thank you for all these things. I believe they are indeed all very important. What has astonished me the most in creating an environment, and that's what I would look for first and foremost, all those aspects that you talk about are really important, but it doesn't make sense if you don't have an actual environment. And let me explain what I mean with that. Does anybody, I'm hoping most people would recognize this, open office setup. So in my last consulting assignment was with a large insurance company in the Netherlands, really, really huge. They had also gone massively towards open offices. And then you get these types of environment. Now, this is not an environment for me that is an environment of engagement, commitment, spirited discussions, and so on. This is very silent. And that might seem good from a sort of, I don't know, manager, facilitation, whatever, or facilities perspective. It's not an environment that certainly wouldn't inspire me. And then on top of that, we've got these clean desk policies in a lot of companies. And if I would translate that to our world, often even worse, a clean wall policies, where you have to keep the walls clean. And I like, how can people interact, have conversations, figure out difficult stuff together, solve complex issues, create complex high technology, whatever stuff together, change ideas, discuss over ideas, and so that is engagement. Engaging meaning going all the way, throwing your ideas and figuring out the best possible solutions together. And in the end, that's why we want to become more agile, right? Because we live in complex environments. The work that we do is often very complex. You can't solve complexity by sitting individually, silent, with a headphone after your behind your desk. So clean walls, open offices, not helpful. Now, obviously, nowadays, we're all first forced to work from home. So telework is the new thing now. I believe there are some people across the world that get their hopes up high, believing, dreaming that telework will become the new normal. Actually, I don't think that's a good idea. It might be a good idea, like open offices for office work. Open offices for office work, brilliant, great. Open offices for creative, complex work that is based upon teams and figuring out stuff together, really, really not helpful. If you're keeping silent, although you have an urgent question, you have an option, you have something to share, and you're keeping silent because if you speak up too loudly, and somebody 10 yards away from you is going to look angry, and that's why you keep silent, that's really, really, really not helpful. Or even worse, you send a text message to like the colleague that's two seats away from you, or an email. Like, oh my God, do you know how much sort of delay, waste you create in the collaboration, and how much information gets lost, rather than just being able to just say what you have to say and share it on the spot. So we've come from this idea that we locked people, we put people into little physical silos called cubicles or separate rooms or whatever. So little cubicles that everybody had to work in. We have removed the cubicles and we've gone all the way to the other extreme, totally open. Now, for working as a team, solving complex stuff, working together, figuring out stuff together, both of them are not what you want. You don't want to lock people into cubicles. You don't want to put them in open offices, because actually putting them in an open office, like you see in the background, it's still, they're still now locked in mental cubicles. Everybody's still working in a little cubicle because they can't speak, they've got their headphones on, and so on. So, and it's that sort of perfect harmony that might seem great from the outside. It's not how you solve complex things. It's not how you produce complex results. And people are still disconnected. So we had a lot of disconnectedness with cubicles and silos and so on. Now, this sort of environment is still full of disconnectedness, and even with the telework. And I want to add a little. So my idea, what do you need to get that sort of that level of engagement up is, first make sure that there's an environment in which people can actually engage. And then it's about trust, psychological safety, and so on. Without that sort of almost physical environment, it will never happen. And by the way, it's not just the physical environment. If you're working with a distributed team, with people across the world or across regions, those people still need a virtual team space. Yeah, a team space that they can organize for themselves, that nobody tells them what to do, what not to do, not clean wall policies, not clean desk policies, things that they can organize for themselves without being disrupted or distracted by people outside. Now, thinking about that telework becoming the new normal. So Scott already kindly introduced that I wrote indeed, I didn't write it. I was the editor of a new book. So 97 things every Scrum practitioner should know. Fascinating journey, collecting essays and articles from, in the end, turned out 68 people besides me. And then turned out 97 was really a lot. Now, that book was finished before the COVID crisis. And there was one guy, he's called Daniel James Gullo, an American guy, CSD, working Scrum Alliance, and lots of other initiatives. He contributed an article that was called, the title, The Effects of Working from Home. And I added to that, so the effects of working from home on teamwork. And just please think about this when you're talking to people that say that telework is going to be the new normal. Telework for teamwork will have the same effect as open offices. You cannot engage, you cannot talk to each other, you cannot really engage. And Daniel, I copied a couple of statements that Daniel made, because we are social beings. We are human creatures. We are human beings. We need social interaction. And the social interaction face-to-face in person is so much more rich than not in-person telework. So we just, as human beings, we need immediate, we need the non-verbal feedback, we need the body language, you need to see facial expressions and so on. And if you're locked in a situation that you're doing telework too often or too much, so too high a proportion of your time, it means you reduce the number of opportunities to really almost earn the respect of the people that you work with, because that's how we are wired. It's sort of in our brains as human beings. And it means in terms of going through the stages of group development, I'm sort of assuming most people would know that from Tuckman. So the forming, storming, norming, and so on. Now, it means that people that have to do telework all the time and still pretend to be a team, it means they don't have enough real opportunities to sort of almost clash with each other, cooperate, healthy forms of conflict. So they will not grow to that state of high performance. So think about it. Open offices, telework, great for office work, maybe not so great for teamwork, where you need collective skills, collective intelligence, all brought together and work towards shared objectives and shared results. So a little sidestep.
Gunther, I think there's a question on the slider that might fit neatly here. Someone's asked, how can we keep engaged during our extended time teams working remotely, and they wanted to know, do you have any case studies from your experience so we can be more efficient working remotely?
No, I don't have any case studies, no, but it's I don't know, for me this is sort of common sense, but it seems for certain large organization it is not. Imagine that you would have to work remotely. That might be different reasons, that may be still some portion of telework. You want to approach that sort of in-person team atmosphere as much as possible. That for me at least means having full-time, real-time communication channels open. Imagine that you have a distributed team working in a couple of locations. It at least means that in every location, there's a sort of screen full-time on, real-time. So that at least rather than asking somebody to who's sitting next to me, I can still go up to the screen, give a little shout out to the team in, I don't know, some faraway country, so that they immediately hear me and can respond to me. So approach that as closely as possible. But it will still not be the same as a co-located setting. But we nowadays, and that's sort of the advantage maybe of the COVID crisis, that we are discovering online communication a lot more, virtual communication, and that we can approach that co-located situation better than we used to do in the past. But it's all about communication and collaboration. Keep up collaboration. Actually, in Scrum terms, so Scrum is a way to deal with complex problems, complex challenges, and complex situations. Working remotely increases complexity. It means for me to be even more disciplined in how you do Scrum. And certainly not just wait for the daily Scrum. You need more communication. You need more communication, more collaboration, more feedback from each other rather than less. A lot of people seem to be going for less communication. I would say more communication. Closing the loops, closing your feedback loops within the sprint even sooner than just at the daily Scrum. Is that helpful?
I can't speak on behalf of them, but I'm sure it was. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you. So we've seen what people are currently measuring. We all believe that engagement is really important because engaged people, engaged employees actually care a lot more. We do understand that business outcomes are important. I don't believe that velocity and those things are really good indicators of engagement. Imagine you go back to your company and the simple idea of having a team space, you introduce a simple idea of having a team space as a start, so that you can start building up trust, psychological safety, and so on. And you start working, you start discovering each other, start collaborating, getting to know each other, also at a personal level, because that's also helpful if you want to grow to some sort of high collaborative state as a team. And imagine you're establishing more like an environment of Scrum, a team space, really doing Scrum, putting things on the walls, being connected to remote parts of the team all the time. What would you prefer to monitor and measure in terms of business outcomes? Because business outcomes are still important. So we know what is currently being measured. And in my little side conversation with Scott, it was clear that Scott said, well, they're actually either are not measuring or certainly measuring the wrong stuff, which is less helpful stuff. I come to assume that a lot of people will recognize that measuring velocity is not really helpful. Unless you want to keep blaming and judging people, but let's try to get over that. So here's my next question for you to take to your breakout rooms. Imagine you're establishing an environment of Scrum. You're really using Scrum. You're trying to get more out of Scrum. And you want to help people think in terms of what should we now measure? What should we now monitor? What are metrics, whatever that we want to use in terms of business outcomes and productivity and performance again? But now in a world of Scrum. So thank you for entering some keywords. Let's take 30 more seconds. And sort of clear winner, can we call it? Customer satisfaction. So if you're counting customer happiness top of that, so what metrics would you use? NPS, Net Promoter Score, is often used for customer satisfaction measurement, business value, the value delivered, team satisfaction, engagement, value delivered. Okay, wow, cool. So customer satisfaction. Just to go into that a little bit, customer satisfaction probably very important. A difficult thing that I found with at least some companies is that even if they do NPS types of things, service and so on, customer satisfaction, it's always very difficult in a world of Scrum to limit that or get that back to the level of the product. So you're measuring a sort of satisfaction of your user base, your consumer base with the organization or the enterprise. It's seldom about, imagine as a product owner, about your product. So it's very difficult to work with customer satisfaction for your product. But it's actually probably a very important one. Okay, so thank you for all of the input. Now, in Scrum terms, what would you measure? I've been struggling with definitions of Scrum sometimes. This is my latest definition, just to be clear, from a paper I wrote not too long ago. It's one of the positive effects of the COVID thing. I was locked into my home. All assignments dropped out, all classes canceled. So suddenly huge amounts of time available. So I created a paper called Moving the Scrum Downfield. And it boils down to the bottom definition of Scrum. So what is Scrum? A simple framework that enables people, it's all about people, to derive value from complex challenges. So Scrum, simple framework, it's about people and then deriving value. So what about taking value for a purpose? Indeed. And then when working these things through, it means value, that is a very different thing than volume. So if you think back at what is currently being measured, you'll probably see that a lot of those things have to do with volume. How much are you producing in terms of output? How much output are you creating? Are you producing? Are you releasing? So the shift that we're looking for, and it just indicated sort of from velocity to things like customer satisfaction, is stop pushing for more output in terms of value and start optimizing. You still have to create output, but start optimizing the outcome of your output. So in Scrum terms, an increment, a releasable version of your product, is actually an output. And you can increase the amount of output, more features, more functionality. It is still not necessarily helpful. So that's certainly a shift that we're looking for in terms of what are you pushing for, what are you optimizing for. Stop pushing for increased output and start optimizing for outcome, meaning value. And that reminded me of work that I did. So I've been around for a while in this beautiful world of Agile and Scrum. So from 2013 until 2016, I worked with Scrum.org, so the organization of Ken Schwaber, and I worked as a partner of Ken. And in that time, we created something that we called the Agility Path Framework. It was a framework that actually was intended to help managers move their focus away from teams and actual team performance and individual performance and move towards thinking in terms of value. So, and that was the goal. I often compare this to, you can have a car and you have the engine of the car and you have a certain amount of horsepower, and you've got all these people are sort of overly focused on the horsepower, the power, the engine, the power that you can produce. How fast can the car drive? Sort of how great and how performant is the team? But we feel, and I still feel, that the role of management, stakeholders, whatever, let's call them in general, management, in a world of Scrum, like in any other world, should be about, are we heading in the right direction? Can the car drive safely? Is the road clear? Are there not too much blocks ahead? Is there not too many impediments? Not too many difficult times? And that's sort of the idea. Are we looking at sort of the horizon that we're working against, that we're working towards, rather than looking at the power, the potential of the car? And in the end, what is the point of having a sort of car with a Formula One engine when you have to drive on a cobblestone road that is full of traffic lights and full of blockages and full of uncertain turns, and that in the end it turns out that you're driving in the wrong direction anyhow. So how helpful is it then that focus on that sort of individual performance? And a way that you can see that this shift is actually happening, so moving away from volume and towards thinking in terms of value, might be that your sprint reviews, in terms of the Scrum process, that your sprint reviews revolve around the question, how much potential value has this team or have these teams created in this sprint? And that is a very different conversation than using the sprint review to quickly do a demo and then make sure that did everybody do their work according to their estimates. So the essential units from an external perspective in Scrum are, it's not about individuals and tasks, it's about the team. It's about the team. It's about the sprint in terms of time. And it's not about estimates and did you do all of the work. It's not even about volume. It's about how much potential impact could we create with the work that you've done. So it's about volume. What would be the outcome of your work, of your output? And we miserably failed in getting this idea across and this framework across. So at some point in time, the decision was made to sort of split off the measurement part, so sort of separated from the holistic framework. And that, by the way, to give you some history, turned into what is still called nowadays evidence-based management. So that was sort of the measurement part of the framework. But this is, for me, a very important shift. Managers, stakeholders, whatever, visiting your sprint review, trying to figure out how much potential value has this team created in this sprint, rather than judging, assessing people, asking them to log their work and justify what they've done. Help them look at how much value did you create. That was the idea behind the Agility Path framework. I nowadays call it more like exploratory management of value. It's in the framework still. So to help people, we wanted to do what you just did in my little menti.com thing. We wanted to help them think in terms of, yeah, but what should we then measure? Cool, Gunther, you want us to not focus on the performance, old school terms, performance of the team or individuals within the team. You want us to look at value. How do we do that? What is it then that we should inspect? Because it's all about inspection adaptation, right? And that's what we called key value indicators. And I know maybe, I don't think I was drunk when I made it up because I don't drink. Maybe some sort of illusion of creativity that came over me. You know, this idea of key performance indicators, KPIs. I felt like, let's give people some better alternative to that. Let's call them key value indicators rather than key performance. Key value indicators, not KPIs, but KVIs. And we wanted to help people think in terms of value with some potential indicators. So indicators of the fact that, over the fact that, are you actually delivering value? Are you able to create value, yes or no? And we assembled a number of possible indicators and we put them into sort of by then three groups. I think nowadays it's four groups. And I still, so 50 years old, I can't adopt anymore and innovate. So I'm sticking to the old ideas. So we put them into three value areas. And one of them was sort of value in itself. It's often called current value or actual value. And we identified a couple of possible parameters for that, or possible metrics. Now, as you can see on the screen, I call them samples. There are examples. I want to help people. It's a framework. We should help people figure out what should we measure in our world, our context, our products, our consumer base, our organization. What should be an indication of value, current value? But the three that most often come back, at least two, is one, financial returns. And I think you saw a number of indications in what you would measure. Customer satisfaction, but also, and here we go, team engagement. And the idea behind this is current value, the work you do and how you do the work, that it does include introducing Scrum. The work you do and how you do the work, that means via Scrum, should bring value to the organization via the stakeholders. And in a commercial organization, that would be something with money, probably benefits, profits, market share, I don't know. And value to your consumer base, the people that use your products, that use your services, that consume your things. That is obvious, but there should also be value to the people that do the work. Think of it in these terms. What is the point of making high profits, even having a highly satisfied customer base, but having very dissatisfied or actively disengaged people? That is not helpful. And the whole underlying idea of that shift from performance of the team towards value should also hopefully emphasize with managers and stakeholders the idea that Scrum in itself is not the goal. Scrum should help you achieve your real goals, more value, higher value. So how you do Scrum, you can in a way be totally compliant with the Scrum guide. And a while ago, probably a year ago, I made up a little blog note with 10 essential questions about your Scrum. You can say yes to every question and still not being able to produce really high value. So think about it. Scrum is a way to do stuff. Scrum in itself is not the goal. But Scrum is a very simple way, the most simple way that I know to achieve those things. So think about it. Scrum is not the goal. Even if you're doing perfectly compliant Scrum, maybe the next step should be about what are we trying to do with our Scrum? And that would be value. And you could think in terms of regularly measuring some of those key value indicators, all of them, all of the most important ones. The idea between the three areas is current value, your actual current value. And then the next one, which I called adaptability, is your ability to sustain that value. So that's in a way, repeat value. How often can you release? How much work do you still have to do after sprints and so on? What's your actual lead cycle time? How much distractions do you have in your sprints? How much are you being pulled away to external meetings or people mess up your team composition and so on? That is what I call unfocused time. So the ability to sustain your creation of value. And the third one is what I call innovation. You can call that new value. So you've got actual or current value, you've got repeat value, and you've got new value. Because it's not because you have high value now and a high ability to sustain that value, that next year that will still be the best thing to do. You want to keep looking for possible new sources of value, new products, new services, new ideas, innovate, even in total, maybe totally different product lines. So that was sort of the idea. And the idea was to get away stakeholders, managers from judging, blaming, assessing whatever people for how they do Scrum, how they do estimates and so on. Look at the outcome of their work. Now,
so Gunther, there was a question, just I don't want to cut you short, but there was a question coming from Greg in the chat before. He was saying, do you think companies are afraid to share how much value was created? And then he's got, because they are afraid of people will ask for more money based on the increased value they provided to the company. So do you think companies are afraid to share how much value was created?
It depends a little bit on more money. Who it's to be shared with. For me, this is all part of the inspection adaptation process. So this is a way, sort of an empirical management loop or an exploratory management loop on top of your Scrum. Sorry, it's all about inspection adaptation. That does require transparency. You cannot honestly inspect your value so that you do some adaptations, and I'll come back on that, without having the right transparency. Now, the strange thing with transparency, and I made that explicit in that paper, Moving Your Scrum Downfield, transparency serves the inspection adaptation process. There's an enormous sort of abuse of the term transparency that I see in organizations. People see transparency as the obligation to make any sort of information available to anybody. That was never the idea of transparency in terms of Scrum, transparency of the foundation of inspection adaptation, meaning transparency means those figures, those indicators should be available to anybody involved in the actual inspection adaptation process that can have a meaningful contribution to that process. So that's one aspect. And the difficulty with the next difficulty with transparency, and maybe that's what Craig is hinting at. Obviously, everybody loves transparency. It's a great word. It's a positive word. It's a beautiful word. Everybody loves transparency. Everybody says that they embrace transparency, that they strive for transparency. Like we all say that engaged people actually care a lot more. That's obvious. Now, the problem with transparency, and that's probably the problem with the key value indicators, is that we are not so happy with transparency if a situation is revealed over which we are not so happy. It's not according to our expectations. It is not what we were hoping for. It's not living up to our dreams. And then suddenly transparency becomes a lot more difficult. So the inspection adaptation process of Scrum needs transparency. You want to inspect reality. It also makes things transparent. So it also creates transparency for better or for worse. And then the difficulty in embracing transparency, that if you're, for whatever reason, your key value indicators are not what you were hoping for, get people to think in terms of iterations. We'll do something. We'll try to do something about it so that it's not about the exact measurement or the exactness of one specific metric. It's doing metrics regularly, repeatedly, so that you can start looking at trends and evolutions and get away from, that's where a lot of KPIs go wrong, that people take, can I say that, to take them too seriously. And that's a couple of aspects with transparency. And it is difficult because a lot of organizations are hesitant to embrace transparency if it reveals that things are not going as they were hoping for. Yep. Okay. So, but that is actually very important because this is all about inspection adaptation at some sort of additional feedback loop on top of your Scrum. That's why I've put your Scrum zone in which you can do perfectly Scrum. But you know what? You can also use Scrum to produce more stuff quicker, faster, even with higher quality, that is still not increasing customer satisfaction, that is not making that making sure that your product gets adopted more, that people upgrade to the latest release and so on, that is not making you money. So it's more than just volume, sort of the additional layer to Scrum. Now, let's go into your breakout rooms one more time. Maybe. One more time after this. Yeah. And here's a question I have for you. So from those key value indicators, looking at the sort of what we call the primary metrics, so the current or the actual value, meaning financial returns, customer satisfaction, team engagement. So imagine you've set up this environment of Scrum. You brought up lots of ideas for key value indicators, things that you want to help stakeholders, managers, and product owners think about and regularly measure so that they can see trends, evolutions. And imagine that it boils down to those three. In your current organization, just think about, imagine you would just present those three. Yeah, I think high level, we should think about financial returns. I think we should think about customer satisfaction. I also think we should think about, that's a lot of things, by the way, about team engagement. What do you think? So not your preference, what do you think in your organization people would look at first and why? So can you take 5 minutes in the breakout room to think about this question? So from the three primary KPIs, what do you think your organization would see? Oh yeah, if you would measure one thing, this would be the one. So thanks all for your votes. But sort of a very good representation of most figures I see. So thank you for that. And then about this thing called agility path. So looking back and evidence-based management, so looking back at the work that Ken and I did on it and how we promoted it, the only guidance that we did not give and we should have given that is that at what level or sort of for what scope would you do this? Now, the obvious level in an environment of Scrum, because you can't measure value if you don't have sort of end-to-end responsibility, end-to-end accountability, if you can't deliver end-to-end value. So the minimal level of value in a world of Scrum would be product. Because all Scrum is about product. You have a product backlog, you have a product owner. Your increment should be a releasable version of your product. And a product is something that you can release, that you can deliver, that you can share with consumers. Otherwise, it makes no sense to measure value. So think about that. I've put it in my paper, moving your Scrum downfield. Without clearly identifying your product, it is almost impossible to effectively use Scrum, because you would use Scrum for a component, a subpart, a little part. So think about what is our product and organize or reorganize, reimagine your Scrum for your product. That seems to be very difficult, because in a lot of agile transformations, what I miss is not just the fact that people do not foresee team spaces, but also a lot, most organizations I know, they establish Scrum teams within existing departments, which are often silos, which are often groups of people focusing on building parts of a product. They still have to hand over the work to other people, and nobody has the global overview of the product. So thinking about what is our product and then organizing your Scrum and your Scrum teams to optimally serve your product is a step that most organizations think they can skip, but actually they shouldn't and they can't. They could just stop doing Scrum again, because it's not going to help a lot. So, and maybe by bringing up value indicators or value measurements, maybe it brings up the idea within the organization that you have sort of suboptimally organized your Scrum at a team, department, a sort of silo level. Now, where is the synergy across the teams? And that's often at the product level. So think about it. What is the product? Who is going to use our product? Are that the real end users? Are we producing work that actually virtually is going to be worked on by other teams within the organization? Because that adds delays, waste, handovers, lots of information, and so on. So just think about it. What is the scope of your Scrum? Hopefully you will think about it when you think about value. What is value? Impact. And the fact that you can quickly deliver an increment to the other team is not helpful in value, because you still have your low lead cycle times and so on. Now, to come back to your what you just did in Menti, here's my statement: team engagement is the key. So I started presenting about engagement a while ago, and at some point I changed my message. My message used to be team engagement is key, and then I changed it to team engagement is the key, not just key. So looking at those three primary KVIs, imagine you doing the following and you're convincing people that forget the other metrics. Don't measure financial returns. Don't measure customer satisfaction. Totally focus on team engagement. Totally focus on creating an environment that helps people, that inspires people, where people find their intrinsic motivation again, an environment that people love to come to. And you know what? Almost as a gift, you will get financial returns, you will get customer satisfaction, because that's what we agreed upon. Employees who are engaged actually care a lot more about team outcomes, about customer satisfaction, about the financial returns. If people care about the organization and they're willing to engage for the organization, they will care about those aspects. Now imagine thinking in terms of improvement. Where can you do better? Globally, except for the US and Canada, globally, you've got an untapped potential of 85% of your workforce. You can try to create an environment in which they will find their inspiration again, their energy, so that they can engage for the company again. Imagine that. Imagine a company of 1,000 people. You can uplift, you can upgrade your level of engagement from 15% to 20% to 30%. Imagine all those people now engaged for the company, being inspired by the work of the company, by the purpose, the vision, or whatever of the company, and really going the extra mile. So that's, you don't have an 85% improvement room on financial returns or customer satisfaction, to put it sort of economically. So team engagement is the key, and it's the most underused thing. Like you just indicated in your indicators, imagine you would bring up those three to your management, stakeholders, sponsors, the CFO, whatever. Most of them would go for the financial aspect anyhow. So go for team engagement, because you've had 85%, maybe only 70%, but even 70% of unengaged people is still a lot of room for improvement. So, and then to end the talk, and then I hope you've enjoyed it. Like I said a couple of times, it's all about inspection adaptation. So measuring value, you do that repeatedly. So that's in a feedback loop. You do that maybe at the sprint review, you want to take into account that some things have some sort of lagging effect. So it takes some time before you see the effect of your actions. But you know what? Just measuring is pointless, because it's inspection without adaptation. So that's for whole of Scrum. Every event in Scrum has a purpose in helping you adapt towards something, upon something. So inspection is only the start. That's why I feel a little bit sorry about the fact that in EBM, we only focused on the inspection part, the measurements. We've sort of let people go in thinking about adaptations, but inspection without adaptation is actually pointless in Scrum. Nothing in Scrum is about reporting, logging, justifying, and so on. It's all about helping you become more agile, being more adaptive. So that also works for this. So the shift that we're looking for, again, is stop managing for tasks and individual performance and start creating, fostering an environment. It's a bounded environment. It's an environment that has boundaries. Within those boundaries, allow people to do their work and get your control, your subtle control from the boundaries. So start fostering an environment where people can actually engage again, go for that work, do their work, self-organize in a way. And that's sort of the idea of agility path. So inspection is only the start. The idea is, what are you going to do with the result of your inspection? Your interpretation of the metrics, your interpretation of evolutions and trends and so on. Is customer satisfaction going up? Then even you want to think about it. If it's just flatlining, going down, it's not about good, bad. It's an iterative, incremental world. It's about how can you use that information to try to do something about it. So that's the goal. And the adaptation that you're looking for in terms of inspecting the key value indicators is, what are sort of meaningful adaptations in terms of what can we do to help the teams create more or start creating potential value in the next couple of sprints? And it is not looking at the horsepower of the engine again, but it's looking at, do they have the skills? Do they have the availability of people? Do they have the ability to self-organize? Are they not dragged into external meetings all the time? Do they have access to systems? Do they have authorizations? Do they have automation in place? What can we do at the sprint review? So starting from the question, how much potential value has this team created in that sprint? Make sure that your sprint review converges towards answering that question by saying, what can we do to help these people, these teams, this team, create more value in the next sprint? Bring in value ideas, bring in market changes that you know of, bring in feedback from actual usage, bring up impediments. And again, that is a very different conversation than having a sprint review that is about justifying that you lived up to your estimates, and then creating the expectation that in the next sprint you will build everything that you will promise, or at least a high percentage of what you will promise. That is not the idea of value. That is the idea of volume. Volume is not value. So, and that's the adaptation that we're looking for. How is that scrum zone functioning? What can we do from the boundaries to help them perform better, to do more? What can we do to clear the way, to remove impediments, to increase their level of self-organization, to give them team stability? What can we do? Is there a lacking team space? Might be a very important thing. Oh, you're not happy with the results, the impact of what we're doing? Well, you know what? We can't talk too loudly. We would love a team space. What can I do to help you create a team space? Yep. And sort of my closing statement, we're not going to lock you into the breakout rooms, but just first an indication that this actually works. This is from the STEAM report from the Gallup Institute, and they have compared organizations that have high level of engagement versus organizations that have low levels of engagement. And they saw fascinating differences in terms of what we just called possible metrics. So consumer metrics, customer metrics, productivity metrics, sales metrics, profitability, and so on. But also in terms of team engagement, in terms of people not leaving the company all the time, people not moving on all the time, companies not being able to attract new, young, intelligent talents because they have this very old-fashioned image on the market and so on. So the productivity sales metrics were a lot better with high levels of team engagement. And the other metrics were a lot lower, so that means a lot better. So this actually is proven by research that focusing on team engagement actually works. But it seems to be very difficult. And that's my last question for you. So let me go back to the Mentimeter and then share that with you. So not in a breakout room, but here's my last question for you. So I believe Scrum and how Scrum implements Agile is a way to help people find their level, increase their levels of engagement, sort of find their intrinsic motivation again. We talked about a number of times. Looking at your organization, what do you think is the biggest impediment to Agile being that way to unlock engagement? What is the biggest impediment to Agile? You've got three keywords, so you can introduce three impediments, by the way, but what is the biggest impediment to Agile in your view, your belief? So management, letting go of pathways. Yeah. Those two are often connected, by the way. People not being able to let go of pathways at the management level, mindset, behaviors. Thank you. I like the thing, the wrong reasons for Agile. Often it's about faster, quicker, more, without minding what we just talked about, value, impact. It's about impact. It's about outcome. It's not about more output. It's about the right output so that you can have an impact. Culture, micromanagement. Management style, decisions. Output-driven calls or the wrong calls in a way. It's what we started with, right, today. What are you currently measuring or what's your organization currently measuring? They're often measuring the wrong stuff. They're measuring the stuff that we used to measure in the industrial age, which will not work in the creative, dynamic, complex, whatever, information age or digital age. We need the agile paradigm. Okay, cool. Thank you. Lots of things. These are probably the biggest impediments that you want your Scrum Masters to work upon. Because fostering that environment of Scrum, that environment where people can engage, that's actually one of the core purposes of Scrum Masters, right? So share this with your Scrum Masters, work with them. Thank you very much for bringing up those things. A lot of recognizable stuff. At the heart of this is what you said is management. What for me is very important is in my humanizing the workplace ambition, managers are humans too. So treat them as humans, treat them as people, approach them, not from what I see happening in a lot of large organizations. We're going to do Scrum. As from now, you are obsolete. Now, really helpful to get Scrum adopted. My personal stance is I'm here to help you rethink your role, your work in a world of Scrum. That means stop focusing on individuals and tasks and go for value. And for me, impediments are never people. It's always processes, behaviors, and so on. And what I see as the biggest impediment to Agile is our ingrained obsession with controlling individuals. We breathe down their necks. We don't believe them. We don't trust them. Whatever. We don't give them an environment. We don't trust them to even organize their work in a sprint of only 2 weeks and keeping out of it. So this is sort of, let's say, my closing statement. The biggest impediment to Agile is our ingrained obsession with controlling individuals. So we don't look at fostering an environment. We don't look at value. We look at estimates as well.